going to discuss the law of radioactivity. In the last module, we had studied the properties of alpha particle, beta particles and gamma rays. So moving forward towards the law of radioactive decay. So if we have a radioactive sample, so it would emit certain particles from it, and if there are some initial number of atoms in it, due to the decay of the particles, the number of atoms goes on decreasing. So this decrease, this decay in the radioactive sample leads to the law of radioactivity. So here we calculate the rate of disintegration, that at what time, in what time it will decrease, it will decay, that what is the decrease in the number of atoms for a particular interval of time. So if we have the rate of disintegration as dN by dt, we know that this decay, this rate of decay is proportional to the initial number of atoms that were present in the sample. So it is proportional to the number of atoms present in the sample at time t. So if I'm looking for a particular time t, we are proportional, rate is proportional to the number of atoms present at that time. If we are seeing at the initial time, it will be proportional to the number of atoms present at the time t equal to 0. So that is why we have written dN by dt is proportional to n, or dN by dt is equal to minus lambda n. When we remove the proportionality constant, we get a constant of proportionality, that is lambda. And since with time, the number of atoms is decreasing in the sample, so there is a negative sign. So therefore, negative sign is the decrease in n with time t. So lambda is called the disintegration constant, or it is called the decay constant, or it is called the radioactive constant. So lambda is named with many names. So when we integrate this expression and take n to the left hand side and dt to the right hand side, we have the equation that dn upon n integral is equal to minus lambda dt. And since there here the integral is over t, so we have the limit from initial value of the time is 0 time till the time t. And at time t equal to 0, what was the number of atoms in the sample present? That was n naught. And at t, what is the number of atoms present? That is n. So when we integrate, what we get? Dn by n is log n. So when we do this, is as this is log n. So here we have two limits, there are n naught to n. So when we open the upper limit, so we get log n minus log of n naught. So this we get as log en, log to the base en minus log to the base n naught. So from the right hand side, we get minus lambda is constant, is taken out of the integral, and the integration over dt is taken out to be t. So taking t, we get t minus of 0, because initial time t naught is 0. So what we hear here, the bracket solve is coming out to be equal to t. So we get the expression log n minus log n naught is nothing but log of n upon n naught, which is equal to minus lambda t. So taking the exponential on both the sides, we get n upon n naught is equal to e ki power minus lambda t, or n is equal to n naught e ki power minus lambda t. So this is our decay law. So here it is proved that the number of atoms is getting reduced with respect to the initial number of atoms exponentially, that it is decreased exponentially by a factor of lambda t. So if we plot a graph here, here we have the, on the y-axis we have the number of atoms, and on the x-axis we have the time t. So at time t equal to 0, we have the initial number of atoms, that is n naught. So as the time progresses, the number of atoms starts on decreasing. It is not here that the number of atoms will decrease very immediately or abruptly. It will decrease exponentially, and it will take a very large time to decay the number of atoms to zero. Approximately we can say that t would be infinite to decay the number of atoms to zero. So this is an exponential decay curve, where it is showing that the number of atoms of the radioactive sample is decreasing with respect to time t. So in this equation, so we have got here that n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t. So now what we do, if we take this t equal to 1 upon lambda, when we substitute t equal to 1 by lambda in this equation, we get n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda इंटू टी की जगह पे क्या पुट किया है, वन अपॉन लैम्डा. सो लैम्डा लैम्डा गेट्स कैंसल्ड, वी गेट एन नॉट ई की पावर माइनस वन. सो एक्सपोनेंशियल टू द पावर माइनस वन इज नथिंग बट एन नॉट अपॉन ई. सो वॉट वी गेट एन इज इक्वल टू एन नॉट बाय ई. दिस मीन्स दैट द नंबर ऑफ एटम हैज बीन रिड्यूस्ड टू 1 by e times of its initial number of atoms, that is n naught. So when will this happen? This will happen when t was substituted as 1 by lambda. So we can calculate the radioactive constant or the decay constant. So the radioactive constant lambda is the reciprocal of the time. If t is equal to 1 by lambda, this means lambda is equal to 1 by t. So, the radioactive constant is the reciprocal of the time during which the number of atoms of radioactive substance reduces to 1 upon e times of its original value. Original value is n naught. So, the number of atoms has been reduced to 1 by e times its original value. So from this decay law, we had calculated in what time will the number of atoms decay to 1 by e of the original value, and this also gives the definition of the decay constant. From this expression, we can also derive the mass decay law or the activity law. So similarly, on the parallel basis of the parallel lines of the number of atoms, if we assume that there are m naught is the initial mass of the radioactive sample and m is the present mass after some particles had decayed from it, so then instead of n equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t, we can also write m is equal to m naught e to the power minus lambda t. So we can also say that this equation holds for the mass also. Similarly, we can derive the expression for the activity, where activity is what? Activity is the number of disintegrations per second, or r is also regarded as lambda into n. Since it is lambda into n, so if we have n, substituting the value of n, we can say here that n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t, and here we get lambda n naught. So for lambda n naught, we can substitute the value r. So r naught, so it is e. So we get r is equal to r naught e to the power minus lambda t. So we can see that r is equal to lambda into n. For n we have substituted, n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t. So lambda into n naught, multiplication of lambda into n naught has been substituted as initial r naught activity. So r is equal to r naught e to the power minus lambda t. So here you see that we have derived the same relation for the activity also. So r naught is the initial activity, r is the activity at time t, so it can be written as r is equal to r naught e to the power minus lambda t, and this relation is called the activity law. So in this law of radioactive decay, I think you have understood how to calculate the decay law, that is n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t, how we can derive the definition of the decay constant, and how this relation has also been used to find the mass decay law or the activity law. In this, we shall also be studying how to calculate the relationship between the half-life period and the decay constant, or the average lifetime and the decay constant, and how the half-life time and the average time has been interrelated with each other. So we proceed to the next topic, that is the half-life period. So in the half-life period, we have denoted the symbol t half. This half-life period is denoted by t half. So what do you mean by half-life time? Half-life time means it is the time in which half the number of atoms of the radioactive sample has been reduced. So what time it takes to reduce its number of atoms to half of its original value, that period is called the half-life time. So the interval in which the number of undecayed radioactive atoms are reduced, or they are left, or half of the atom had decayed, that time interval will give you the half-life time. So we know that at t equal to 0, n naught is the number of radioactive atoms, and at t is equal to t half, at t half time, what will be the number of atoms? that will be half of the original value, that is n naught by 2. So when we substitute the values in the decay law, we get for at time t equal to t half, when we put t equal to t half, then n is to be replaced by n naught by 2. So n naught by 2 is n naught e to the power minus lambda t half. So n naught gets cancelled, we get 2 to the power minus 1 is e to the power minus lambda t half. Rearranging the term, we can say that 2 is equal to e to power lambda t half. And taking log on both the sides, we have log 2 is equal to lambda t half. Now, we want to calculate the value of t half, that is the half lifetime. So t half is nothing but log 2 by lambda. So t half is log 2 upon lambda. Now, converting the log to the base e to the log to the base 10. So we have to multiply it by 2.3026. So it becomes 2.3026 log to the base 10 into 2 upon lambda. So log 2 is 1.414. So multiplying 2.3026 with 1.414, we get 0.693. So t half is nothing but 0.693 by lambda. So since 0.693 is a constant value, so what does this mean? This means that half lifetime is inversely proportional to, it is inversely proportional to lambda. So t half is inversely proportional to the decay constant. So if the value of lambda is large, t half will be small. So t half value small means that the radioactive sample will disintegrate into half of the atom. It will decay into half of the atoms in very quick time. So larger the value of lambda, more rapidly the number of atoms will be decreased. And this t half, half lifetime, is the characteristic of the radioactive sample. It is its characteristic property. It does not depend that we can change the value of the t half. It cannot be said. If uranium has a half lifetime of something 10 raised to power 9 years, so we cannot change it to 1 year. So this is the characteristic property of the material of the radioactive sample, that what is its lifetime, which cannot be altered. So t half cannot be altered in a radioactive material and is the characteristic property. So we have seen here that t half is 0.693 by lambda. So half lifetime can be deduced by using this formula. If we know the decay constant, we can calculate the half lifetime. Or if we know the half lifetime, we can calculate the decay constant. So next, coming up to the next topic, that is the average or mean lifetime. So what do you mean by average time? Average time is the time that is taken by all the atoms of the radioactive sample through which they have lived in the sample. So to calculate the average or the mean lifetime, which is denoted by TA, that is T average, it is written that T average is the ratio of sum of lives of all atoms, that how much life had all atoms lived before disintegrating, upon how many were the total number of atoms. So we know that initially at time t equal to 0, what is the total number of atoms? N naught. Okay, so at t equal to 0, there were n naught number of atoms. So if we have at time t, that at time t the number of atoms which had survived is n. So from the decay law, n is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t. So we derivate the equation. So we have dn by dt is equal to minus lambda n naught e to the power minus lambda t. Because n naught is constant, it would not affect in the differentiation. Taking the derivative of exponential, minus lambda comes in the numerator. So here we have minus lambda n naught e to the power minus lambda t. So this means that these dn number of nuclei have lived for t seconds before decaying. So if we want to calculate the life of these dn, so what is the life of the dn? It has stayed lived for t seconds. So the total life of dn nuclei will be t into dn. So if we want to now calculate the life of all the nuclei that were present in the radioactive sample, that is the n naught nuclei time, so t total will be what? T total will be nothing but the integration of this term Tdn from integrating with respect to n when it was initial number, that is n naught, and when it has decayed completely, when the number of atoms is zero in the sample. Here we have taken a modulus of dn because we have to calculate the lifetime. So lifetime is what? Lifetime is a time. It is never negative in quantity. So therefore we have to take a positive quantity, and since the dn is involving a negative sign here, so we have to take the modulus. So the total life will be integral from n is equal to n naught to 0 tdn. Now substituting the value of dn from the above equation in this equation, what we get? We get t total is from n naught to 0 t into lambda n naught e to power minus lambda t dt. Now since the integration has to be carried on t, so we have to change the limits from n to t. So we know that when n is equal to n naught, so n is equal to n naught at what time? It was at initial time when t is equal to 0. And when will be the number of atoms equal to 0? When it would be infinite time, because it takes infinite years, infinite time to reduce the number of atoms to 0, to completely finish. So for n is equal to n naught, t is equal to 0, and n is 0 for t equal to infinity. So substituting the values of t, we have t total is equal to 0 to infinity lambda n naught t e to the power minus lambda t dt. So here lambda n naught is constant, it can be taken out. So here you have lambda n naught, and in the integral you are left with t e to the power minus lambda t dt. Now here we have two terms of the function of t. So this function, these two functions will be integrated by parts, and we have to take the islet function. So integrating by parts, we get t total will be lambda n naught t to the power minus lambda t upon minus lambda, minus of integral e to the power minus lambda t upon minus lambda dt. So carrying out these calculations, we find out that we get minus lambda n naught upon lambda e to the power minus lambda t plus 1. So when we substitute t equal to infinity here, so e to the power minus infinity is what? It is e to the power 1 upon e to the power infinity, which is 1 upon infinity, which is 0. So here we have 0. And when we put 0 here, so it is again 0. So 0 minus 0 is 0. So here you have 0 for this term, and there is a plus sign also. So here you get a 1. Okay? So we have what? We get a minus sign here. So we get minus of minus is n naught by lambda. So by simple calculations, we can prove that t total is n naught upon lambda. So we have come to our end that the t average is the t total. Here we have written t average is t total upon total number of atoms. So total number of atoms is n naught. So t total has been calculated to be n naught by lambda. So t average is n naught by lambda into 1 by n naught. So n naught gets cancelled, we get 1 by lambda. So t average is what? T average is nothing but is inversely proportional to the decay constant lambda. But we also know that t half is what? T half is 0.693 upon lambda. So but 1 by lambda is ta. So instead of 1 by lambda, what we can substitute? So we can substitute here as t half is 0.693 of ta. So t half is what? T half is 0.693 ta. What we have written here? We have also written here that t half is 0.693 ta. So we are able to calculate that the half-life time is 0.693 times of the average time. In this way, we can calculate the average time, decay constant, or the half-life time if any of the two quantities or one quantity is known. So next, from these we can derive the units of activity. As I have already discussed earlier also, that activity means that what is the time in which there would be disintegration. So here we discuss the units of activity. So activity means how many disintegrations are carried in what interval of time. So activity is given by the relation R is equal to lambda n, and also we know that R is equal to R naught e to the power minus lambda t. So activity also decreases exponentially with respect to time. So the Becquerel scientist had first of all discovered the radioactivity accidentally. So he gave the units of activity as 1 Becquerel. That is 1 BQ is 1 disintegration per second. Means in 1 second there is 1 disintegration. So this is 1 Becquerel. And 1 gigabecquerel is 1 GBQ, which is 10 raised to power 9 becquerels. And 10 raised to power 9 can be split up as 10 raised to power 3 into 10 raised to power 6. Where this 10 raised to power 6 becquerels can be written as 1 megabecquerel. So 1 gigabecquerel is nothing but 10 to the power 3 megabecquerel, or it is 1000 megabecquerels. Similarly, Curie also had given the units of activity. So Curie said that 1 Curie of activity will be when there will be 3.7 into 10 raised to power 10 disintegrations per second. In 1 second there would be 3.7 or 37 into 10 raised to power 9 disintegration per second. So if we say this is a 37 into 10 to power 9. So we know that 10 to power 9 is giga. So what we will say that it is equal to 37 gigabecquerels. So 1 microcurie will be, if we substitute micro, here 10 to power minus 6 is multiplied here. So it will be 10 to power 4. So 1 microcurie is 37 into 10 to power 3 disintegration per second. And 1 millicurie will be subsequently 37 into 10 to power 6 disintegration per second. Similarly, Rutherford had also given the units of activity as Rutherford. And in this, 1 Rutherford is what? 1 Rutherford is 10 to power 6 disintegrations per second. In 1 second, there will be 10 to power 6 disintegration or 1 mega disintegration. So 1 milli Rutherford will be 10 raised to power 3. Milli is 10 raised to power minus 3 into 10 raised to power 6, which is 10 raised to power 3. So 1 milli Rutherford is 10 to power 3 disintegration per second. And in 1 micro, it would be 1 minus 6 into 10 to power 6, which will be equal to 1. So this is equal to 1 disintegration per second. So it is clear that 1 becquerel is 1 disintegration, 1 micro Rutherford is 1 disintegration. So we can say that 1 micro Rutherford is equal to 1 becquerel. Is it clear? 1 micro Rutherford is equal to 1 becquerel of activity. So I think that you have all understood the concept of the radioactive law, half-life time, average law, average time, and the units of activity. So, thank you.